One of the fascinating things about food webs is you do see the same patterns coming up again and again. So for example, if I had a parasitoid network from my back garden, it wouldn't look that different to the parasitoid networks we collected at the tops of mountains in Hawaii. So you do see the same patterns coming out again and again. I mean, in general, you'll find there's a few well-connected species in a network and a lot of species that are much more kind of peripheral to things. I'm going to show you how we actually visualise a food web. So starting at the bottom of the food web, we've got all the plants. So what we've done here is we've counted leaves or flowers or seeds, some part of the plant. So we add the caterpillars in this particular case. So this is the herbivore part of the community. This is a common caterpillar. This is a rare caterpillar. And these are all of the caterpillar species in this particular plot. So up here we've got the parasitoid community, a common parasitoid and a rare parasitoid. And the different color codes in this case tell us something about the biology of the organisms. The thing that makes the food webs really useful though is we know who's feeding on who. So for example, that particular caterpillar species here is feeding on this particular plant species. The parasitoid up here is feeding on that caterpillar species. And it's feeding on more than one species though. As you see, if I fill in the rest of the community, it looks like this. This parasitoid here is feeding on two species of caterpillar. This one here, which is the commonest one in the community, is actually feeding on five different species. One, two, three, four, five. But it's mostly feeding on these two caterpillars. So this is the architecture of the network. You can plot these networks in various ways. This is the way that I use it, because it's the way I'm used to reading these things. But you can plot them in 3D, and you can twizzle them around in space, and they look just fantastic. Study food webs is really very useful when considering pollination, because traditionally people look at the crop and what visits it. If you look at that in a network context, you need to know if you've got a key pollinator, to consider the pollinator, you've got to consider what's happening outside of the crop's flowering season. If it's a bumblebee, it's going to emerge in April, March, April. You need to know what, you need food plants around then. So if you look more holistically at the whole picture of the lifespan, then you can see how the pollinator and the crop fits into a much bigger picture. Then ideally you can manage that network to actually, you know, favour the insects you're after for the pollination services and make sure they're there year after year, and you know, you'll get sustainable pollination that way. It's important to study pollinating insects because an awful lot of the food we depend on as humans comes from, you know, is the result of pollination. So while wheat might be wind pollinated, say, all the soft fruits, beans, and a whole variety of other plants are dependent upon pollination. We can't, you know, as people, we cannot kind of recreate that service any other way. We're dependent on wild and managed pollinators. So without pollinators, we'd get rather hungry. We need to know which insect species are pollinating which crop species and which insect species can pollinate them. So can we manage these communities better? Rather than just sitting back and hoping we're doing the right things, we need to know more about which environmental stewardship schemes really work. We know that the pollen and nectar mixes can be, you know, really rather effective, but there's still an awful lot we need to know. So what can we do to make life better for the pollinators, so we can then actually, you know, basically reap the rewards of this in terms of, you know, good pollination services? It could well be disastrous for UK agriculture if we lost major pollinating species. I mean, if things like the bumblebees all disappeared, solitary bees, some of the hoverflies can be surprisingly important. If those insects start disappearing, so basically there's no spare parts left in the system, then we, you know, we would see food productivity potentially drop, potentially fairly catastrophically. Food webs are an excellent tool for modelling extinctions at the community level, because what you can do is actually, when you've got your food web, you've spent a long summer putting together this data, you can load it up onto the computer, and then you can model the effect of removing species. So you can take out species one by one according to various rules. So for example, you could remove the rare species, as those are the ones most likely to go extinct. Or you could take some of the really well-connected species out, like the bumblebees in a pollination network, or take out the honeybee, and actually ask, well, how many linked extinctions are there? How many plants, how many crops and native plants are left high and dry with no visits at all? And there's good theory to suggest that taking out just a handful of well-connected species can actually lead to the collapse of a network. In pollination networks, you get patterns whereby plants that actually have a very highly generalised, so lots of things visit them, tend to attract the really rare species in the community. So again, in pollination networks, my pollination networks from local farms don't look that different to pollination networks from urban habitats or from nature reserves. There are subtle differences, and one of the million-dollar questions is actually asking, well, you know, is there a fingerprint of some sort of environmental problem that you can see on a network? Is there some subtle pattern that tells you it's about to kind of start having serious problems? If you could predict that before it happens, then that's really interesting.